So far in this series of videos, we have mainly been looking at the innate immune response. Before we dive into the adaptive response, it will be helpful to understand a bit more about the anatomy of the immune system that helps these cells develop and move around the body. As well as the circulatory system, the body has a parallel system called the lymphatic system, which helps organise and coordinate the immune response. In order to progress our understanding of the immune system, we need to explore the lymphatic system, which not only includes the lymph vessels and lymph nodes, but also the primary and secondary immune organs and tissues, such as the thymus, bone marrow, spleen, and mucosa-associated lymphoid tissues, such as the tonsils and adenoids, which we introduced, albeit briefly, at the start of this course. As we have discussed so far, the immune system is made up of millions of cells and soluble components that react to the presence of foreign surfaces or damaged cell tissue. But something that we haven't spoken much about is the checkpoints that are in place to ensure that immune cells do not react inappropriately against our body and only react to the presence of these threats in a controlled manner. Nor have we thought about how these cells manage to find one another amongst the millions of other circulating cells. And this is where the lymphatic system comes into play. Perhaps the best analogy that I've heard of what the lymphatic system does was given by Hank Green of Crash Course fame, and that is to imagine the immune cells contained in the high-pressure circulatory system are passengers at an airport trying to get through the security checkpoint as quickly as possible to get to their destination. The trouble with pushing people through security quickly is that potential threats may also manage to sneak their way through, which is why occasionally the security guards ask random individuals to step out of the line and be subjected to a more in-depth search. This slower moving line is the equivalent of the lymphatic system, which takes some of the fluid out of the blood and helps it recirculate the body, but at the same time, it screens that fluid for any potential threats. The lymphatic system is not just a parallel series of vessels. It also contains a series of additional checkpoints called lymph nodes. These lymph nodes contain macrophages and dendritic cells that are able to deal with some minor threats directly via phagocytosis, but can also then trigger the immune system and activate it to help deal with more severe threats. The lymphatic system is made up of three main parts. Firstly, the lymph itself, which is a watery fluid that is forced out of the circulation in the capillary beds to allow the exchange of gases and nutrients from the blood into the tissues. Then, the lymphatic vessels that allow the lymph to recirculate around the body so that it can be reabsorbed into the blood. Along the way are a series of between 600 and 700 lymph nodes that act as a series of security checkpoints, inspecting the lymph and cleansing it to ensure no potential pathogens are circulating the body. Finally, other lymphoid tissues, including the primary organs, which are the red bone marrow and thymus, and the secondary organs, which include the spleen, tonsils, Peyer's patches, and specialised tissue around mucosal membrane, called mucosa-associated lymphoid tissues, or MALTs. Some of these tissues and organs house specialised immune cells that help defend us against harmful pathogens, whilst others, particularly the bone marrow, thymus, and spleen, act as sites where immune cells can develop and mature. So where does the lymph come from? Well, approximately 20 litres of fluid is forced out of the arterioles through the capillary beds to allow the exchange of gases and nutrients every day. A vast majority of that interstitial fluid is reabsorbed at the venous end of the capillary bed due to osmotic pressure. However, about 3 litres remains unabsorbed, and this is what becomes lymphatic fluid or lymph. The unabsorbed fluid is almost immediately taken up by capillaries of the lymph system, which wind their way between the blood capillaries. And physiologically, they are really well suited to their job, being made of overlapping endothelial cells that form a series of flap-like valves that only open in one direction, allowing the interstitial fluid to flow into the lymph vessels. Once in the lymphatic system, it moves towards the area of lowest pressure in the blood circulatory system so that it can be returned to your blood. This is important, otherwise your blood volume would steadily decrease due to the loss of the fluid and you would ultimately die. Now, you may be wondering how 20 litres of fluid is forced out of the blood each day when the average human only has a blood volume of approximately 5 litres to start with. But you need to remember that blood is circulating the body multiple times per day. That 20 litres is the accumulative daily volume and doesn't happen all at once. The lymph vessels function much like blood vessels, with a series of valves that prevent lymph flowing back down the vessel. A combination of smooth muscle in the vessel walls reacting to the contraction of nearby skeletal muscle, combined with a difference in pressure between the capillary bed end and the thoracic end, propels the lymph through the vessels back towards the heart region, where it can re-enter the circulation. Now, the lymphatic system is not just returning that fluid to the blood to keep you alive. It is also helping check that your body doesn't have any pathogenic invaders, and this is the function of the lymph nodes. Multiple afferent or incoming lymph vessels can feed into a single lymph node, which is surrounded by a protective capsule. The lymph fluid enters the sinuses of the node, which are lined by macrophages and dendritic cells, which sample the lymph for the presence of any potential pathogens. Lymph leaves the nodes via the efferent or outgoing lymph vessel. The lymph node is highly structured and contains a range of immune cells, including macrophages, B and T lymphocytes, which are key cells of the adaptive immune response. Each of these cells are contained within defined regions of the lymph node. The B lymphocytes are mainly contained within the primary lymphoid follicles, which are closest to the capsule. Then, if we move deeper, we come to the paracortical areas, which is home to the T lymphocytes, and is also where activated dendritic cells end up after they have sampled a potential pathogen elsewhere in the body. Macrophages are mainly found within the medullary cords and sinuses, where they have the best chance of interacting with and phagocytosing any lymph-borne pathogens. The reason for this structure will become clearer when we look at the activation of the adaptive immune response. Lymph nodes aren't the only checkpoints, though. We also have the thymus and spleen, as well as a series of specialised areas outside the lymphatic system that are strategically placed around areas of tissue that are susceptible to pathogen entry. So, for example, your digestive or respiratory tract, and these are known as mucosa-associated lymphoid tissues, or MALTs, as they are found within the mucosal membranes of the tissues they protect. Examples of MALTs include your tonsils and Peyer's patches in the small intestine, and even the appendix, which we are often told is useless in humans, but in actual fact is well placed to destroy any pathogens that have so far evaded the other gut defences. The thymus plays a fundamental role in immune system development, but unlike the lymph nodes that facilitate interactions between pathogens and cells of the immune system, the thymus is the site of early T lymphocyte development. It sits directly above the heart and is most active during infancy, steadily decreasing in activity and becoming atrophied or shrinking in size as we age. T lymphocyte progenitors are produced by the bone marrow and migrate to the thymus, where they interact with thymic, stromal and epithelial cells, which guide their maturation and development. As with the lymph nodes, the thymus is structured and distinct regions can be identified, including the medulla and cortex. Less mature T cells migrate from the cortex to the medulla as they develop. And once fully matured, the T cells leave the thymus and circulate through the blood system, entering the lymph nodes in the paracortical regions. The spleen is the largest lymphatic organ, about the size of a fist, that sits roughly around the stomach region. It has two main functions. Firstly, to remove old red blood cells from circulation, which occurs in the red pulp region, and secondly, to filter pathogens and immune complexes from the blood, which mainly occurs in the white pulp. Unlike lymph nodes, however, the spleen does not filter lymph, only blood, and holds an important reserve of monocytes, as well as red blood cells and platelets. Pathogens that are circulating in the blood are destroyed by macrophages that are resident in the red pulp region, and the white pulp is interspersed in this red pulp and has a similar structure to lymph nodes, with B cell follicles and T cell zones. In the spleen, the T cell zones surround the arterioles in a region called the periarticular lymphoid sheath, or PALS. Sitting outside these sheaths are the B cell follicles, which are surrounded by the marginal zone. The marginal zone is important because this is where splenic macrophages and dendritic cells are able to filter out circulating antigens and blood-borne pathogens. Mucosa-associated lymphoid tissues are found throughout the body, and the example shown here is the Peyer's patch, which is found in the small intestine. But there are also MALTs associated with the airways, urogenital tract, lactating breast, salivary glands, eyes, and skin. We also find MALTs in the appendix, the tonsils, and the adenoid glands. And the reason we need these walls is because mucosal membranes are often very thin, sometimes only a single layer thick. And this allows for the exchange of things like gases or nutrients, but also makes them very susceptible as an entry point for microbes. Taking the gut as an example, the gut-associated lymphoid tissue, or GALT, contains specialised M cells, which constantly provide antigens from the gut lumen to the underlying Peyer's patch, which contains regions of dendritic cells, T and B lymphocytes, much like the lymph nodes, with a large central region of B lymphocytes surrounded by T lymphocytes and resident dendritic cells, which are able to activate these lymphocytes. Immune activity in GALT is tightly regulated, because it is also constantly exposed to the harmless commensal bacteria that make up our gut microbiome and the food we eat, neither of which we want to mount an immune response to. We also have types of mold in the airway, in particular the nasal passage and bronchi, called nasal-associated and bronchus-associated lymphoid tissues, or NALT and BALT, respectively. The M cells here are constantly sampling the inhaled air and mucus for the presence of pathogens. The airway molds are also often patrolled by lymphocytes, even when there is not an infection, which enhances the speed of the immune response. That's a broad overview of the main organs and tissues of the immune system. It was important to discuss these, as the structural organisation of the lymph nodes plays a fundamental role in adaptive immune activation, while the thymus is fundamental for T lymphocyte maturation, both of which we will talk about in more detail as we start to explore the adaptive immune response over the next few videos.